The orchestra is my piano. I go there, I cannot hold a baton. And before to start, for example, the Brandenburg Third, in my head, it's tacatão, 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 tacatão. And this kind of impulse I had all my life as a pianist. And now I try to, I think I will have till the rest of my life with my orchestra.
Well, I used to be a concert pianist. I took my first piano lesson when I was 8 years old. And after 6 months, I won a Bach competition playing Bach inventions. When I was 20 years old, I made my debut in Carnegie Hall. And then I had a fantastic career. But when I was 26 years old, I had my first accident playing football. I had the rupture of my cubital nerve. And I had to go through surgeries. I had to do physiotherapy, and after a few years, I got back at Carnegie Hall again, playing Bach, Weltempered Clavier, first book. At the university, in 17 days, every single work that Bach wrote for keyboard, and everything by heart. And the only time this was done before was by Claudia Rau, before the First War. And I tell you, you cannot imagine to keep everything in memory. In 17 consecutive nights, because suddenly the fugues starts to mixing in your head. But I can tell you, I didn't have any kind of memory lapse. So I think I don't know if I was a good pianist, but I can say that I have a good memory. Thank you. After my treatment in Miami, when I arrived at the Jackson Memorial Hospital after the mugging in Bulgaria, I couldn't move my right arm. So, when I got back to Carnegie Hall, you cannot imagine the kind of emotion that I had before to walk on the stage.
Ontem, o paulista do Brooklyn, João Carlos Martins, voltou ao palco do Carnegie Hall em Nova York para tocar com a orquestra American Symphony. Foi seu primeiro concerto em 11 anos. Primeiro, um concerto só para a mão esquerda, de Ravel. Depois, um concerto do argentino Rinastera, uma das peças mais difíceis já escritas para o piano. Martins foi ovacionado de pé por 5 minutos. Poucas vezes se viu isso no Carnegie Hall.
When I lost my right hand and I couldn't play anymore with this finger, the third finger, but I still had some muscle in my right hand, I still did a recording of a Haydn and Mozart sonatas.
Lost my right hand definitely. It was a very sad thing because I was mugged in Sofia, in Bulgaria, and I had a brain concussion. And after all the problems that I had with my right hand, when I had this brain concussion, then I lost all my movements on my right hand. And I stayed 8 months at the Jackson Memorial Hospital in Miami. 4 years ago, I canceled the concert 2 minutes before. It's impossible. I cannot live anymore. Should I kill myself? Should I try a new life?
most people find it difficult to build one career, but you already built two and you're building a third career.
Yes, I'm trying. I had two careers as a pianist. The first half of my career, the first part, I played with all major symphonies. And in the second half of my career, then I played mostly recitals.
Yes.
And then I was already involved with the Bach keyboard works, very much involved. So it was a dream from 8 till 26, and a nightmare from 26 till 6, and now it's a dream again after my first lesson when I start to conduct. Infelizmente, chegamos ao final do nosso programa. Até a próxima semana. Outro dia, a minha penúltima apresentação foi em Curitiba. E, de repente, quem apresentou foi a Maria Fernanda Cândido. E aí, no comecinho, ela começou a olhar para a minha mão e nós começamos a achar que eu pensava comigo, acho que essa moça é fresca, ela achava que eu era fresco. De repente, a gente se achou as duas pessoas mais maravilhosas do mundo, mas eu estava preocupado achando que ela estava olhando para a minha mão, entende?
Então, e ela estava preocupada achando que você estava olhando para onde, né? O negócio de focar, não é? Você deu muita importância ao negócio de focar, de estar concentrado. O que, que já te aconteceu por causa disso?
Não. Eu, quando o técnico inglês falou, olha, eu vou falar take one, take two, take three, você fica totalmente focado se a gente tem que repetir. Eu falei para ele, olha, quando tinha 18 anos de idade, eu aprendi a me focar nas coisas mais complicadas. Eu tinha uma namorada no Guarujá e meus amigos já tinham um carro, eu não tinha. Eu falei, não, eu vou me encontrar, mas eu vou deixar meu carro do lado de cá, da balsa. Naquela época que tinha balsa, que a gente entrava a pé na balsa. Aí, eu desci de Expresso Brasileiro, mas eu queria ser pontual.
Sim, e também dizer que tinha o seu carro, então.
Aí eu chego, e aí eu vejo que a balsa. Eu falo, tenho que ser pontual, aí eu estou descendo no ancorador e vejo que só tem uma distância assim entre a balsa e o ancorador. E naquela época não tinha esse negócio de balsinha para pedestre. Todo mundo já entrava e o pessoal saía na frente dos carros da balsa. Quando eu vi uma distância assim, eu falei, eu vou pegar essa balsa é minha. Aí eu dei a maior corrida do mundo, dei um salto e peguei a balsa e derrubei umas três velhinhas para dentro da balsa. E aí o pessoal começou a falar, ô, seu filho da mãe, o que, que é? Aí que eu percebi, a balsa estava chegando.
I was this kind of boy that I was afraid to connect with other children of my age. And then my father bought a piano. And then I took my first piano lesson. Because from this orchestra, I am making another orchestra of young people from 15 to 21 years old. Some of these people, they live in the poor neighborhood of São Paulo. And it's for some of them, I gave a scholarship at the university. Quando a CUT fez uma homenagem para mim no dia 1º de maio, eu trouxe a minha baquiana jovem para que eles pudessem ver a união entre os trabalhadores brasileiros e, ao mesmo tempo, pudessem aprender a reivindicar melhores condições para os músicos clássicos no Brasil.
I find working with young people much more rewarding sometimes because they are so open. They don't have a lifetime of experience, or sometimes bad experience.
Yeah.
And so they are open to absorb all the things you want to say. And
they know that you are not lying.
Yeah.
The others, sometimes they think that you are lying to them.
Or no. Playing games with them.
Yes, but playing games
it's them. A much more direct relationship, isn't it?
Yes,
I love working with youth orchestras.
And some of these young people, they are sometimes playing as soloists in some events of my orchestra. And so these
give... So they're combining.
Yes. Yeah. And then I take, in some concerts, I take 3 or 4 young people to play with the orchestra.
That's very good training.
It's a fantastic training for them, you know. Enquanto estiver tocando, quando você entrar com o tema depois dos violoncelos e você estiver um pouco forte, daqui eu peço para você baixar um pouco a bola. Só as coisas que a gente falou.
Tá
e aí eu só vou parar quando chegar aqui. Tá bom?
Tá
bom. Vamos lá.
Thank you.
I tell you, for example, in this famous Mozart serenata, that we have this very this fantastic phrase. Then I do. You know, it's crazy. You say, my goodness, I don't know if this is Mozart. You can tell me this. And by my conception, it's this one. A guy that work in a mine will listen, and he will say, he is built, this thing is beautiful. And a musicologist will listen, and he will say, I think it is wrong, but it's not ugly.
Thank you.
our job is always about finding a balance. It's a balance between being friendly and being authoritarian. It's about respecting the score, but having our own imagination and combining and finding the balance where we are still respecting the composer, but we are at the same time performing. Yeah. If we just play literally what's on the score, it's dead.
Computer.
Because they don't write enough.
Yes.
Even now, even when you get to a composer like Benjamin Britten or somebody who marks so much detail, there are still 1,000 questions on every bar, exactly how, because there are so many ways you can play every note on every instrument. And in an orchestra, there are so many instruments, and every single thing can be balanced differently. You read the score, and then you listen to the recording made by the composer himself, and you think, well, it says that, but he did that. I mean, if you are too literal, you kill the music.
Yes.
Of course, you can be crazy, and there is a fashion now for many conductors to say, okay, everybody's done that, now I've got to do it a different way, so that everybody thinks I'm different. And being different just for the sake of it is crazy.
I know.
That's not creative. It's not. You know, you can imagine anything. You can do anything to make it different if you want to be stupid enough.
Yeah.
But if you respect the music, you respect the composer, but you have another idea to do something extra with it, which you like and which you really believe in, if you are a good musician, why not?
The important thing, it's always to try to do everything with good taste.
Yeah.
If you do with good taste, for example, if I'm going to play, I played everything that Bach wrote for keyboard. I am trying to build my conception of this work. I know that I am a poor human being here, and Bach was a kind of God for me. But when I am going to play his music, it's like if I am having a dialogue with him in the same, like I'm having a dialogue with you. I will say, look, Mr. Johann, I like this in a much faster way. I like this in a much romantic way. I like this. If we don't have this kind, not of authority, but if we cannot mix our individuality with the personality of the composer, we are dead. I always tried to have a kind of detaché touch. And today, my orchestra is my piano. For example, in this trio of Brandenburg I, the oboe, suddenly, he sounds in the repetition almost as a detaché touch of a pianist. It's crazy, but it's my idea. Thank you.
first time that I tried my career was for love. Second time was for hope. Third time was for determination. Now last time is for fun.
Nice to meet you. I know you're from television, so I have seen this film they made about you. I was in a hotel room. And
I heard all your CDs.
All my CDs. So.
And I am crazy about your playing and a lot of Brazilian musicians.
Oh, thank you very much.
And even the first oboist of my orchestra is from England. Uh-huh. And he told me, you are going to be with the best oboist in the world today. Yeah, they are crazy about you.
No, but I have to make the difference. I play the 19th and 18th century.
I know.
On Modern Oboe, I'm not playing anymore.
This is why you cannot come to play with us.
Well, that's one of the problems.
But indeed, already because everybody, they were so excited to have you to play with us.
I was in Latin America last week.
I know, in Argentina.
Argentina and Peru, Venezuela. And Colombia.
And Colombia.
But not in Brazil.
But perhaps in 2007 you can come then with your group.
Yeah,
no?
Maybe we can organize this. Yeah, it would be great.
Okay, but I was crazy about your CDs that Johan gave it to me.
Do we walk in the
yeah,
city?
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, fantastic.
I know that you like to be always on time, you know? Me too. I am crazy about that.
A lot of musicians, I think the artists, they're never in time, but you have to be in time.
I always
also, when you play, you have to be in time.
No, if I can follow you in a presto.
Here you have already an idea of...
fantastic.
I will show you how it has to look like.
Oh my God.
See, that's now this part of the instrument. Eh?
Fantastic. Oh, this was a great thing. Great thing. How long does it take to make one?
Well, it takes a lot of time because, first of all, you have to cut the wood. It has to dry. And something very important, the inside bore of an oboe is conical. It means it goes from small. Here it's very small. It's about 6 millimeters to here. But this is not regular. So I have to make these tools, and maybe I can show you some tools. So I go to a museum. I take the measurements of an instrument. And then I take these measurements on a piece of steel. I turn them on a machine. And then with this machine, I take off the metal. And then I can sharpen it. And this, it's very sharp. Yeah? And then I take a piece of wood. I have to take care that I don't destroy an instrument now. But just to show you. So, and I put this into the instrument. You see, I take the wood away. And I make the inside bore, and this is really important.
For example, you just told me that you used this oboe for the first time in Caracas.
This one, yeah.
In Bogota. In Bogota.
Yeah.
So for the first time, what is the difference between the new one, and the one that you used that 2 months before?
No difference. The other one I had was also a very nice instrument, but a colleague of mine, he said, "I love your instrument," and I say, "I promised him you can have it, and I will make me a new one."
Okay, it's not like in piano that we see a difference in each keyboard, for example. Well,
every oboe is a bit different, but it's the way you play it.
But they have their own soul too, no?
Yeah, of course. They do. And you put also your soul into the instrument. In the beginning, when I have a new instrument, you feel when you blow, the wood is not vibrating. It's like a new piano you have to play, and the wood had to start to vibrate. And then after an hour or two playing it, suddenly you feel that the wood is vibrating under your fingers, and the sound is richer and richer, and it's very nice.
Thank you.
You talk about piano. Obviously, you play Bach on a piano.
Yeah.
So how do you feel about the authentic instruments and the people who play on fortepianos or harpsichords?
I tell you, Bach, he wrote once a letter. In this letter, he said, when he went to see Silbermann piano in 1722-23, but he didn't like Silbermann piano. Because he couldn't play faster, the sound was not good. But then he wrote a letter, and he said, I like the keyboard with the crispness of a harpsichord and the lung of a organ.
Yeah.
So the lung of a organ and the crispness of a harpsichord, it's a modern Steinway. I think it's much easier for you to reconstruct a dinosaur than to know exactly the way Bach played. And you are so elegant every time, but this I still didn't feel. Like if we were behind the curtain, mm-hmm. and we started to come for the party, but we are behind the curtain.
He was born behind the curtain.
Yes.
You should know what it means, you know.
Okay, let's go.
Thank you.
Mestre, como é que vai?
can conduct with your eyes. It's about visual contact. And you see conductors who conduct up in the air or down at the down here. But the ones who make most communication with the orchestra are the ones who are conducting on the eye line. So you conduct like this to them. And eyes are always the direct communication.
Taking Botox injections, and my dream, of course, I don't think I can play anymore, but every day after the Botox, I'm applying every 3 months, I do some exercises. Who knows? Suddenly they do a hand transplant, or perhaps this hand can play again. I don't know, but I just do it. Why not?